Hey, Team Kids, Mr. Steve, I've come down to the church once again, but you're not here. So we're just going to have to do these Team Kid lessons on videos again. But I've really been missing you. I've missed times studying these Team Kid lessons and all that. And I hope sometime soon we're able to get back together. And I don't really know when that'll be, but I'm hoping that we'll get to come back. And, you know, even if we have to wear a mask, maybe we can get together and have a lesson time and a snack and a story, even if we can't do the whole thing like we used to. But we do have a Team Kid lesson today, and I want you to take a few seconds and go find your trusty Team Kid Bible and get it. Hit pause if you need to. Go get your Bible, and when you get back, hit play again, and let's dive into this lesson. So today, we're going to be in John chapter 14 and 15. And in my Bible, that is on page 613. And if you've got your Team Kid Bible, it's the same page. But when you open your Bible and you look at John chapter 14, right out the gate, you're going to notice that they printed it in a different color. And the reason that it's printed in red is this is called a red letter edition of the Bible. And every time Jesus says some words, they print them in red so we will know that he's the one doing the talking. So when you're reading your Bible, if it's in black, it could be somebody else that's talking or just what God really wants us to know. But the actual words Jesus spoke are going to be in red. So today we're going to start a new unit. We're going to have six lessons in this unit. That's a lot. Six lessons, but today's the first lesson in how we can know what the truth is. So I wanted to give you an example, and let's just say that there are some men sitting around a table, maybe boys and girls, and one of them says that one thing is true, and another one says that another thing is true, and they can't seem to agree on what is true. Well, as we study these lessons in these next six weeks, we're going to find out what the truth is. And that's God's truth, and no one can dispute what God has said. Well, they might question it, but they'd be wrong, wouldn't they? Because what God says is truth. John chapter 14, beginning in verse 1, and we're going to read through verse 7. Don't let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If not, I would have told you. I'm going away to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself so that where I am, you may be also. You know the way to where I'm going. Lord, Thomas said, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will also know my Father. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Well, that's pretty interesting scripture right there, because like I said, most of that is what Jesus actually said. And I want you to have a couple of takeaways from this, okay? First of all, let's look there in verse 2, where it says, in my Father's house are many rooms. And that's talking about heaven. And he says, if not, I would have told you. But then he finishes that saying, I'm going to prepare a place for you. Now, one thing that you can get from these scriptures, Jesus was talking to his followers, his disciples, and we are disciples of Jesus if we believe in him. So, in a way, he's talking to us. He's telling us that he's gone to heaven, and that he's prepared a place for us. And that in verse 3 says, if I go and prepare that place for you, I will come again and take you to myself so that you may be where I am. And that's important. He's gone to heaven. He's prepared a place for us as well. And one day he's going to come and take us there. And he says, you know how to get where I'm going. And then Thomas says, but Jesus, we don't know how to get where you're going. And he makes it very clear. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will also know my Father. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." So Jesus says in this, and this is one of those things I was talking about. Let's say that there are some people in this world, and there are, that believe there's lots of ways that you can get to heaven. Jesus cleared it up right there. He said that he is the way to heaven. And if people want to argue about what the truth is, he says that he is the truth. And still there in verse 6, he says, if people want to say that there's lots of ways to live forever, he says that he's the life. He's the only way that we can get to heaven and have everlasting life. So it's interesting. Jesus talks about that if we've seen him, we've seen the Father. And if we know him, we know the Father. And it's important because that helps us to really believe that Jesus is God. And he said so in his word. And we've said that that God's word is true. There's nothing in Scripture that is not true. So we can believe every bit of that. All right, let's go to chapter 15. Turn the page. We'll be on page 614 in verses 1 through 17. This is long. It says, "I am the vine, I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. Every branch in me that does not produce fruit, he removes, and he prunes every branch that produces fruit so that it will produce more fruit. You are already clean because of the word I've spoken to you. Remain in me and I in you. Just as a branch is unable to produce fruit by itself unless it remains on the vine, neither can you unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. The one who remains in me and I in him produces much fruit, because you can do nothing without me. If anyone does not remain in me, he is thrown aside like a branch and he withers. They gather them, throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask what you want and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you produce much fruit and prove to be my disciples." Verse 9, "As the Father has loved me, I have also loved you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I've told you these things so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. This is my command. Love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, than to lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants anymore, because a servant doesn't know what his master is doing. I have called you friends because I have made known to you everything I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. I appointed you to go and produce fruit, and that your fruit should remain. So whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give to you. This is what I command you. Love one another." Boys and girls, I've got a special guest with us today, Mr. Kerry Clark. He knows a lot about trees, and I thought since John chapter 15, verse 2, talked about pruning trees, we might ask a tree expert. Mr. Kerry, why would somebody, if they looked at a perfectly healthy-looking fruit tree, want to cut part of it off?
There's several reasons somebody might want to cut part of the tree off. It's called pruning. And a lot of times, the limbs, if they grow real long, they get heavy. Hold your arms out, Sawyer. Right out to your side. You see how long you can hold them out like that, okay? So sometimes trees grow really long trying to get to the sunlight, and they get really heavy after they hold them up for a long time. So if you cut them off, that keeps them from breaking off. A lot of times they'll break if they get real, real heavy. And then that makes places for disease, and insects can get into the tree and damage the tree. Another reason that you might want to cut and prune limbs is some of the limbs might be dying or dead, and you want to cut those off so new growth will come. For fruit trees, a lot of times people will prune fruit trees to stimulate growth. And what that means is when you cut one limb off, sometimes three or four will come back and replace that one. And so you get a lot more fruit because you have a lot more limbs.
Last example that you gave right there, Mr. Carey, is exactly what our Bible verse talks about. It talks about pruning a tree so it will give more fruit.
That's why you would want to prune a fruit tree or maybe a tree that has a lot of flowers on it to make it pretty, have more flowers on it.
Great. Now, Mr. Carey, one other question. Does that work for vines like muscadines and grapes and things like that too, that pruning idea?
I think it will. I think it'll work on any kind of plant that produces fruit like that.
Okay. Boys and girls, I told you Mr. Carey is an expert on trees, and I think he just proved it. He also works for the Forestry Service, and he's been out in California fighting forest fires, if you've been seeing that on TV lately. And we just want to thank him for his service. We know that's a very dangerous job, but we're glad he's home safe. Anything else you want to tell the boys and girls, Mr. Carey?
I think that ought to do it.
One thing that we want to do is we want to understand that Jesus says he's the vine. So think about a grape bush or a muscadine bush. And some of your grandparents might have some of those around. And the vine part grows out and the fruit goes at the end of the vine. So the water and the nutrients from the ground all have to go through the vine to get to the fruit. And that's the way Jesus is. If he's the vine and we're the branches, his love has got to go through Jesus to get to us. And he tells us that if we'll stay in him, that we will produce much fruit. Well, what's he talking about when he says people producing fruit? Well, he wants us to tell others about him so that more people will believe in Jesus and be in heaven. So that's the fruit that we are to do. We're to share his love with other people. And when we share his love with others, it shows people that God loves them, just like he revealed himself to us, that he loves us. So that's why we share God's love with other people, so that they might see that God loves them too. Another part of this is he's talking about remaining in him and being connected to Jesus. And you might say, well, Jesus is in heaven. How can I be connected to him? One, you can read his word. And two, you can pray. When you pray, Jesus talks back to you. He lets you know what he wants you to know. So those are some important things. And then the very last thing that I think is probably the most important thing is Jesus says to love one another. And you've all experienced being able to love others in this quarantine time when you've maybe gone to your grandparents' house or you've helped your parents around the house and done some things maybe that sometimes you didn't really know why you were doing it or even if you didn't want to do it, but you did it anyway because you were showing love, you were showing God's love to other people. We had great opportunity to show God's love to other people in this quarantine time. We can't just do nothing. We can call people and talk to them on the phone and let them know that we love them and that we're praying for them and that we care about them. So it's important to us that we show God's love to other people. It's kind of like I've talked about in the past where these verses that Jesus was writing to his disciples are really written to us if we are his disciples. We need to take what he says in these verses and we need to apply them. We need to understand that there's one truth, God's truth. And then we need to understand that he wants us to love one another. So that's what we're going to study the next 5 weeks after this week is how we can really know what the truth is. Jesus said that there was no difference between knowing him and knowing God. And he says in this set of scripture and in others too, that if we've seen him, we've seen God. And While I've never really seen Jesus with my eyes, I've seen what Jesus does in this world a lot. Jesus loves people, and He shows it all the time. So when we see what Jesus does, when we see what Jesus is doing in this world, we're seeing what God is doing too, because they are one and the same. So Jesus used those four words to describe Himself. He said He's the way, the only way, the truth, the real truth, undisputable truth, the life, the everlasting life, and the vine. And remember, the vine gives life to the branches and to the fruit. And we are the branches. And we can't have any fruit unless we abide in Jesus. So study your scripture so that you can abide in Jesus. Pray and talk to Him so that you can abide in Jesus. And love one another. Well, boys and girls, I hope you're getting through all this. And like I said earlier, I hope we can all get back together. I'm willing to wear a mask if we need to. I'm willing to wash my hands a lot if we need to be able to get together. And I hope we get to real soon. Let's pray. Father God, we just thank You for Your many blessings, Lord. And I ask You to be with each boy and girl or even adults, Lord, that are watching this. Let them know that You're with them and that You love them and You care for them. Lord, I just ask that You would help them to share Your love with others in real ways, Lord, that You might be glorified in it and that we might produce the fruit that we've learned about today. I just ask You to be with all the people, Lord, that we know that are sick or are hurting because they've lost loved ones, Lord. Just touch them and heal them and let them know that You are with them, Lord, and give them a peace that surpasses all understanding, Lord, as your Scripture says. Forgive us when we fail You, in Jesus' name. Amen. Boys and girls, I hope to see you soon. Have a great week.